सदाशिवसमारम्भाम् शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्ताम् वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ॐ परं वरिष्ठं ब्रह्मिष्ठं परमानन्दरूपिणम् परमार्थनन्दयतिं सद्गुरुं प्रणतोऽस्म्यहम्। I hope all of you are able to hear me and also see the screen. Thank you. So, in these important verses that we completed in the last class, right, from the 4th verse to the 10th verse of the 9th chapter, Lord Krishna described the Ishvara Swarupam or the nature of God, and we saw that Bhagavan has got two aspects or components. One is called the Paraprakriti, which we saw in detail in the 7th chapter, which is the superior nature, right? Which is nothing but consciousness, which is changeless, attributeless, and divisionless, which we refer to as CAD or CAD, right? So, we also saw that the Sattva Rajo Tamoguna Sahita Apara Prakriti, the one endowed with Sattva Rajas and Tamoguna, is the inferior one called the Apara Prakriti, right? Apara Prakriti is also the world that we see, right? Maya, we refer to it in different names. 7th chapter, we saw it as Para Prakriti and Apara Prakriti. So, first Bhagavan described the Para Prakriti by describing four important features. I'm sure you will remember in the last class we saw that Indriya Atitam, not visible or perceptible to the sense organs, like space, right? Para Prakriti is all. Para Prakriti is all pervading like space, and Para Prakriti accommodates the entire creation just as the space accommodates. So that is Indriya Atita. And then the second one we saw was Sarvagatam or Sarvadharaha or Adhishtanam, right? So, and we also saw later that finally, even though Para Prakriti accommodates everything, it is not tainted by or affected by any event that happens in the creation. Just as space is not contaminated, it is also asangaha, right? We saw all these terms in the last class. Then later Lord Krishna said that Para Prakriti, which is my higher nature, is not involved in any action at all, just as space is akarta, abhokta. Para Prakriti also does not do anything, right? So naturally, no question of reaping the result also. Only if you are a karta, then you are a bhokta. So Para Prakriti is akarta, abhokta. And then blessed by this Para Prakriti or the mere presence of Para Prakriti, the Apara Prakriti, otherwise called Maya, becomes enlivened. This enlivened Apara Prakriti, Maya, alone has got the entire creation in potential form, like the mother carrying a baby in her womb, right? Or just as a seed carries the huge tree within itself, Apara Prakriti seed has got Panchabhutas, the 14 lokas, all our physical bodies, all our minds, everything in unmanifest form. And blessed by Para Prakriti, the Apara Prakriti throws out the creation. And the creation moves about for some time based on the law of karma. Because in Vedanta, in Hinduism, nothing is accepted as random. Randomness is not acceptable to Veda. So it is all governed by the law of karma. Things evolve for some time. Thereafter, they everything will resolve back into apara prakriti. So it will remain there some in the same manner for some time, which is called pralaya avastha, and thereafter again it will emerge called srishti, right? So thereafter again pralayam. So the cycle goes on and on. So thus para prakriti and apara prakriti put together, that is Ishvara, is the cause of everything. So jagat karanam is Ishvara. This description we concluded in the 10th verse, right? Then in the 11th important verse, Lord Krishna says that what is the problem with humanity, right? The nature of Brahman as described in the Upanishad is Sat, Chit and Ananda, right? So it is eternal, all-pervading, changeless and the source of Ananda. This Brahman alone is the only source, right? And in the Vedantic capsule, we actually, one of the capsules is this, if you remember. Otherwise, you can go and refer to my notes, which I've done earlier in Introduction to Vedanta, also repeated in Gita. This Brahman, the Para Prakriti, is the only source of permanent peace, security, and Ananda, right? Para Prakriti is the only source, right? And so, any person who seeks these three permanent security, happiness, right? In short, PSH, whoever is interested in peace, security and happiness must seek para prakriti, and only by the discovery of para prakriti, the human struggle will end, because only by accomplishing that para prakriti, a person will get permanent PSH. Therefore, the human struggles will end when, right? Only when the pursuit of para prakriti is undertaken, and which is called the pursuit of moksha, which is the parama purushartha. Why? Because it is the supreme of the purushartas, right? The other purushartas are dharma, artha, and kama, right? And all Upanishads declare this, that intelligent people recognize this fact very early in life. Therefore, they design their lifestyle for accomplishing Brahman, and Mokshaha is the Parama Purushartha. And they start very early preparation so that they can accomplish the goal of permanent peace, security and happiness in this life itself. I just want to remind you that the Upanishads clearly tells that the dhira, the wise person, is only one who has realized this. And I think I mentioned this, Swamiji always says, God, Ishvara, not only created the world, created the physical beings, the human beings, all of them, and also gave a manual in the form of Vedas so that we can manage our lives better. But unfortunately, by the time we chance upon Vedanta, sometimes multiple janmas go by before we come to this part of the teaching, which is given as part of the creation itself. It is an apaurusheya vishaya. It is part of the creation. Nobody has actually written that, right? So, in the Upanishad, repeatedly it says that your other purushartas are fine, but ultimately, you have to realize that Moksha Purushartha is the only one which can put an end to the human struggle or samsara, right? Now, so all the other worldly goals, right, which seemingly gives us peace, security and happiness, is only temporary, right? So that is why they are also called Kama Purushartha. They are all desires which will give you temporary pleasure, right? Not that it will not give us pleasure, but finally, ultimately, it is all temporary. Even if you take dharma, right, punyam, right, even that will give us a swargaloka, which is also not a permanent swargaloka. Once the punyam is over, you have to return to the next janma, right? So, whatever it is, whether it is artha or kama or dharma, they all have intrinsic limitations, right? So, it is, even earlier I mentioned this, I thought I will put it down in the slide. So, trivida doshaha, three types of doshas, or three intrinsic limitations of apara prakriti. First one is, they all give me pleasures, all right, but the pleasures are mixed with pain. The pain involved in acquiring them, maintaining them, and then always worried that it will go away. Even relationships, right? Once you acquire, you have to work on maintaining them and preserving them, right? That is itself becoming so stressful, right? Even husband and wife relationship itself becomes very stressful when you have to work on keeping the relationship going, right? So, dukkha mishri tattvam, right? Retaining any of these is always mixed with some amount of pain. So, dukkha mishri tattvam. Then the second one, right, is atripti karatvam, right? Now, in spite of acquiring, right, and you know, you have the preservation pain, etc., right? So, we always say that the world has got beauty, the world has got variety, and world has got novelty. But what happens? It is also subject to change, right? So, there is change, it is also having attributes, etc. So, what happens is that the second effect of atripti karatvam is, whatever we accomplish, there will be no tripti ultimately. If I get 100 rupees, I will feel I should get 1000 rupees. If I get 1000, the goalpost will keep on shifting. So, whether it is 1 crore, 100 crores or 1000 crores, I am never satisfied, right? It is the nature of apara prakriti that it is atripti karatvam, right? The intrinsic nature of worldly accomplishments, dissatisfaction and discontentment, all the time comparing with neighbor or a sibling or a friend or a professional colleague, right? And the last problem is bandhakatvam. The more we acquire, the more we depend on these factors to be comfortable and happy. Previously, I would have required 5 factors to be happy. Now, I require 50 factors to be happy, right? I am traveling from dependence to not independence, but from dependence to more dependence. We can even see our TV channels. We used to get in our childhood one channel, right? DD1 maybe, maximum. Then after that, it became 2, 3. And then now we have hundreds, 200s of channels. But still, we are not seeing one channel for even half an hour. We keep on switching, right? So, bandhakatvam, right? It is also an addiction, right? So, any of these is an addiction. So, apara prakriti, right? Whether it is dharma, artha or kama, all of them, right? Are subject to causing a bond, bandhakatvam, right? And this is referred to collectively as prayas in Kathopanishad, right? That is why Kathopanishad, Yamadharmaraja says these three are prayas and shreyaha, moksha is shreya, and only that will give you total fulfillment, right? Now in Kathopanishad, the great boy Nachiketa approaches Yamadharmaraja and asks for moksha. And Yamadharmaraja offers all the worldly assets of land, elephants, gold, horses, right? All of these representing artha, right? Then Nachiketa says, I don't want all of these, right? Then he offers all the sense pleasures of this world, right? And of the heavenly world also. He gives all the tickets free of cost. He says, you can travel, though. You don't even need a ticket. You don't even need a vehicle. You just think you can go wherever you want, right? Then you can have extraordinary entertainment by Ramba, Urvashi. You can have any musical instruments, all of that. This boy Nachiketa, who is just 9 years old, answers, they're all wonderful, but please keep it yourself. So, Yamadharmaraja is stumped, right? Seeing a 9-year-old boy having this much of wisdom, right? But he understood, right, the limitation of worldly accomplishment. Here, Lord Krishna says, even though this is very clear for a thinking person, majority of the people do not know the value of moksha, the value of para prakriti, the value of the real Bhagavan, right? So shreyaha and prayaha, as in Kathopanishad, approaches the man, approaches the human being. Very rarely people seek spirituality, Mostly they will only postpone. First they will say, I have studies. Then they will say, oh, I just got married. I'm too young. Then they'll say, okay, my children. Then they'll say, oh, I'm busy with my office. So they keep on postponing. And by the time they recognize the real value, it has become too late, right? So what happens in Hinduism? Luckily, we have another advantage. So postpone it to next Janma. So we have crossed millions of human Janmas, never pursuing the real Bhagavan. So Lord Krishna says, I am ready to assist the human beings. I have provided the Vedas. I have provided the Gita. And I have provided so many gurus to assist. And even though all these are there, majority do not seek the real goal of life. What is the problem? Ignorance and delusion is the human problem. Right? And this delusion with respect to what? What should the real goal of life be? Right? So this is referred to as Mohaha. In fact, Shankaracharya talks a lot about it in Bhajagovindam. And in the last days of our lives, when one is in the ICU without, you know, people being allowed to meet, etc., at that time, you are wondering, you know, whether you should have spent more time pursuing this spiritual goal, right? So Lord Krishna talks about Ajnana and Mohaha as the human problem. So we had actually completed the 12th verse in the last class, right? Where we saw that Lord Krishna had divided the entire humanity into two. One is the mature, informed group. Another is the immature and uninformed group. So the mature and uninformed group is, the immature uninformed group is confused regarding the priorities of life. Therefore, they don't know moksha is the top priority and initially we pursue artha and kama. So 75% goes towards artha, kama, purushartha and maybe some dharma purushartha and only 25% towards spirituality, the time, right? So gradually, this as we grow in life, we must, you know, design our lifestyle in such a way that artha kama purushartha gets diluted and they are replaced by dharma and moksha purushartha. This well-planned life, which was very aptly designed in the infrastructure in the ashrama vyavastha earlier, we now don't have, and because of which also we are not the immature and indiscriminate ones. Don't follow this, right? So Lord Krishna is speaking about the immature, indiscriminate ones in this verse. And we have to start with verse 13, which is the next group of the other wise group of people. So continuing. Mahatmanastu mam partha, Mahatmanastu mam partha, Daivim prakriti mashritaha, Daivim prakriti mashritaha, Bhajantyananya manasaha, Bhajantyananya manasaha, Nyatma Nyatva Bhutadimavyayam, Nyatva Bhutadimavyayam. So hey Partha, there is another group of humanity which is in minority, right? We've seen in 7th chapter, Manushyanam Shreyaha. There is a minority group because of some Purvajanma Punyam. They have understood the importance of spirituality because of Sattva Guna Pradana. Therefore, he says, Daivim Prakriti Mashritaha. Because of some Punyam, Sattva Guna is predominant in them. And how do we know, understand Sattva Guna predominance? Interest in religious life, interest in spirituality, interest in Bhagavad Gita. All these things can come only when Sattva Guna is slightly more. It need not be, say, 90%. But if it is not more, right, then we will not have this feeling at all of, you know, wanting to listen to Gita, etc., right? So, Devi Prakriti means Sattva Guna. And what do they understand? Bhutadi Mavyayam Nyatva, right? So, Ishvara is referred to as Bhuta Adi. காரணம் ஆஃப் த பூதாதிஹி எஸ் ஈஸ்வரா, தட் இஸ் த காரணம் ஆஃப் த ஜகத், ரைட். சோ பூதாதிஹி மீன்ஸ் ஜகத் காரணம் ஈஸ்வரா, ரைட். ஈவன் தோ தே டோன்ட் நோ வாட் எக்ஸாக்ட்லி காட் இஸ், தே டோன்ட் ஹாவ் அ கிளியர் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங், பட் ஃப்ரம் த ஸ்கிரிப்சர்ஸ் ஆர் ஃப்ரம் த வேர்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் எல்டர்ஸ் தே டூ அக்செப்ட் தட் தெர் இஸ் சம்திங் கால் ஈஸ்வரா. So the Vedic Shraddha itself requires Sattva Guna, right? So therefore they know Ishvara. So scriptures say between Ishvara and Jagat, Ishvara alone is Shashvatam. Everything in this world is Ashashvatam, right? So like this Ganga Haridwar example, right? If you want to hold on to something, right? Especially when you are having a bath in Haridwar and in the Ganges, right? You have to hold on to the chain which is really, really strongly positioned on the bank, right? Then you can enjoy the cool waters. You can get into the water and you can enjoy the flow of the Ganges. If that is not there, if you're not holding on to the chain, then you will have a jolly ride or not so jolly ride in the waters directly, right? So that hook and the chain which is strongly fixed, that is needed, right, for you to enjoy the Ganges. Similarly, we need to hold on to something stable, right, which is, you know, Ishvara, the Paraprakriti nature, so that we can enjoy the rest of our life and the world itself, right, and be involved in worldly vyavahara, right. So therefore, holding on to Ishvara when you are involved in worldly vyavahara, this is called bhakti. Bhakti is born out of Shraddha in the scriptural teaching, right? Now, I learn to hold on to God in the form of one Ishta Devata or another, right? I don't know the real nature of God, right? That's my ultimate goal. Now, I hold on to Bhutadi Magyayam, right? So, the Shashvatam God, right? So, when you ask a true bhakta, what is your ultimate support and security, he will never name any person. He will say God, right? So, what are the different stages of bhakti? Lord Krishna is going to talk about in the following important verses, right? So, O Arjuna, having taken to sattvic nature and having known me to be the imperishable cause of all beings, the noble souls, the second category of people, on the other hand, worship me with an undistracted mind. Continuing, satatam kirtayanto maam, satatam kirtayanto maam, yatantascha dridavrataha, நமஸ்யந்தஶ்ச மாம் பக்த்யா, நமஸ்யந்தஶ்ச மாம் பக்த்யா, நித்ய யுக்தா உபாசதே. Now all the spiritual stages are broadly classified into three: கர்ம யோகா பிரதான lifestyle, உபாசன யோகா பிரதான lifestyle, and ஞான யோகா பிரதான lifestyle. Now, spirituality can never start with Jnana Yoga, right? It can never start directly with renunciation unless you are that small minority which is actually taking up sannyasa, right? Otherwise, in general, spirituality can never start directly with Jnana Yoga, right? So, or renunciation. So, initially, Jnana Yoga is in the form of exposure to the teaching of Gita. That is the minimum level of Jnana Yoga. So, the primary spirituality should begin with what? With Karma Yoga, which we have defined as Pancha Maha Yajna, right? So, Pancha Maha Yajna is the continuous contribution to the surrounding, right? And I should not merely be a consumer, but I should also be a contributor. So, the first contribution is the family, right? Or the ancestors, parents, etc., which is called Pitru Yajna, right? I'm just trying to quickly recall so that we all remember the Pancha Maha Yajna, right? And even after death, Shastra talks about the grateful remembrance and the reverence expressed through them, which is called Pitru Yajna, right? So that is the first one. Then Manushya Yajna, my contribution to the other fellow human beings in the society, right? I contribute to them as per my capacity. Maybe somebody is not well, you donate something for them for some surgeries, etc. Then Brahma Yajnaha, my contribution is the preservation of the Vedic culture, right? The culture itself has to be kept going, right? And otherwise the next generation will not know. For instance, only if I do namaskaram to the elders, my children will do namaskaram to the elders. So they learn more by seeing, right? So Brahma Yajnaha is maintaining the Vedic culture, both the Veda Purva Bhaga and Veda Anta Bhaga, right? So very important, the spiritual growth will happen only then material prosperity in the society will also happen, right? So therefore, developing the practice of offering respect and reverence, all of them also comes under Brahma Yajna, right? All types of parayanams, scriptural reading, right, etc. will come under Brahma Yajna. In fact, tomorrow, Vyoma is already doing this Ramayana chanting. Tomorrow morning, it is Sundara Kandam. So all the parayanams will come under Brahma Yajna only, right? So that is the third one, right? And then we have Daiva Yajna, which is time spent for Ishvara Aradhana. The relationship with Ishvara is very important. We have to nurture it. So every day, some form of Aradhana, Shiva Manasa Puja, Vishnu Sahasranama Parayanam, or mental aradhanam, even Sandhya Vandanam itself for people who can do Sandhya Vandanam, right? Or Aditya Hridayam is the next best option, right? One of the most beautiful spiritual prayers which everybody can chant, right? Whether they do Sandhya Vandanam or not, irrespective of gender, status, religion, nationality, Aditya Hridayam is a very wonderful prayer. Other one is Kamalajadaitashtakam. It's also a very wonderful prayer written by Sringeri Acharya. All of them comes under Ishvara Aradhanam, right? And Kamalaja Daitashtakam, in fact, is put up on the site itself. You can download it if you want, along with Bombay Jayashree's chanting, right? So that is Deva Yajna, right? We have covered Pitru Yajna, Manushya Yajna, Brahma Yajna, and Deva Yajna. And the last one is Bhuta Yajna, right? We remember the contribution of even animals and plants. Therefore, may you reverentially treat them and worship them. Go Puja, Vata Vriksha Puja, Ashwatha Puja, right? So, even in traditional houses, even now we first keep food for the crow to eat. We also put ma kolam or, the rice floor kolam so that the ants can come and eat. This is all Bhuta Yajna. Now, if we put plastic sheet and paste them, the ants will only get hoodwinked, right? Because they cannot eat plastic, right? So, Pancha Maha Yajnas will contribute to my spiritual growth, which is nothing but Karma Yoga. So, all the five Pancha Maha Yajnas contribute, are referred to collectively as Karma Yoga, right? Other than this, of course, our day-to-day work that we do in our profession, in our family, etc., that also we can do with Ishwarartana Bhava and Ishwara Pratada Bhava, and all of them will come under Karma Yoga, right? But mainly Karma Yoga refers to the Pancha Maha Yajna only. And Lord Krishna is referring to that in this shloka. Satatam Kirta Yanto Mam. They constantly do Parayanam Brahma Yajna, right? Even if I don't know the scriptures, at least Vishnu Sahasranama, right? So, and even if I don't know any prayers, they say that the glory of Kali Yuga is what, Kalo Kalmasha Chittanam, Papa Dravyopa Jeevanam, Vidikriya Vihinanam, Gatir Govinda Kirtanam. Right? Kalo Kalmasha Chittanam, mind is full of impurity. Papa Dravya Upajeevanam, we earn money by compromising with values sometimes, right? Even we may have to bribe people, etc. No, we have to do, obviously those kind of things happen, but the person on a spiritual journey is supposed to reduce all of this and bring it to zero, right? Anything unethical, which is not moral, we are not supposed to do, right? So, papa dravya upajivanam, right? So, for all of this, the prayachitam is sandhyavandanam or some chanting, right? So that we can get rid of these papams, right? And in fact, Swami Pooji Swami Dayananda Saraswati says, we must note that in Gayatri Mantram, Diyo Yona Prachodayat, Naha is plural number representing V, right? So it means that it is, the prayer is done for all members of my family. So even if one person does, it is very, very beneficial to the family, right? Now, therefore, vidikriya vihanam. Yeah, vidikriya vihinanam, right? So even without rules and regulations, right? In Kali Yuga, nobody wants to do any of this. So Shastram says, at least you can do one thing. What is that? Datir Govinda Kirtanam. At least take one nama of the Lord and regularly spend at least 10 or 15 minutes and chant Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namo Narayana, any nama. You chant, it is equivalent to Pancha Mahayajna. Therefore, Lord Krishna says, Satatam Kirtayanto Mam, right? So, in the second line, Namashyantascha Mam Bhaktya. Those who are physically fit, they do physical puja, namaskara, pradakshina, etc., right? They are all purifying process. Every namaskara purifies the mind, right? So, only thing is, as long as we are able to do physically, we should do namaskara. Otherwise, vasika namaskara is enough. That's why even in Vishnu Sahasranama, at the end they say, Sri Rama Rameti, right? Which is equivalent to the full Sahasranama Parayanam if I am not able to do it, right? But you cannot use it as a shortcut to not chant the Vishnu Sahasranama, right? If we are all right, we must do the full Parayanam, right? So, Namasyantascha Mam Bhaktya Dridavrataha Yatantaha. So, this is all done for Chitta Shuddhi, right? So, Dridavrataha, with a firm resolve that I want to complete all these three yogas in this life itself, right? All the effort with commitment and a firm resolve. Nitya Yukta with steadfastness, with sincerity, without giving lame excuses, right? So, Nitya Yukta Upasate. With steadfastness, they follow, they worship the Lord. So, this shloka, Karma Yoga summarized. Then, in the next shloka, Lord Krishna is going to talk about Upasana Yoga and Jnana Yoga. Right? So, we'll see verse 15. Jnana Yajnena Chapyanye, Jnana Yajnena Chapyanye. Yajanto mamupasate, yajanto mamupasate, ekatvena pritatvena, bahudha vishvato mukham, bahudha vishvato mukham. One minute, I think I'm running low on the battery. Yeah, okay. So, Upasana Yoga is the discipline of meditation, and meditation is to handle a mind given to preoccupation, right? So, mental preoccupation is a very big obstacle for Jnana Yoga, because Jnana Yoga requires a calm and deep and committed mind to inquire into Jiva Swarupam, to inquire into Ishvara Swarupam, and to discover the essential oneness of Jiva and Ishvara. It requires a mind which is focused and calm, right? Because it is a progressive teaching. Later classes are a build up on the previous classes. So, let us assume that, you know, we forget the classes then and there. Then what will happen? If you forget what is Para Prakriti, right? And what is CAD standing for? the next class you will not be able to relate to what is being spoken about. And every time we have to go back and start from the beginning, which is also not appropriate, right? We won't be able to build up and learn. So reception and retention both are important, right? So intellectual qualification required for serious spiritual students is reception at the time of class, and whatever we learn, it has to be retained in the mind, right? So both of them are required. Now, this is possible only when the mind is 100% available for Shravanam. If the mind should be available 100%, mind should not have any preoccupation, right? If I'm worrying about family members, if I'm worrying about professional problems, naturally only 5 or 10% of the mind is available for Jnana Yoga. Therefore, the benefit is either minimal or nil. So people complain, right, that I read so much but nothing is registering, right? So the reason is because the mind is not free from preoccupation. So I should enjoy a sannyasi mind, right? A sannyasi mind has died to the world, right? How to develop a mind which is free from preoccupation? Even if preoccupations are there, the moment I say Om, right, all the preoccupations should go away, right? So Swamiji normally gives this example of this Wimbledon tennis, right? I think it's a very nice example. You will hear lot of screaming, shouting, etc. But when this I don't know whether you're able to see the PowerPoint. Okay. Oh no. Okay. Let me see one second. Okay, it's fine. Let's continue and maybe I'll complete this and then we can stop. Okay. So I was in, in the verse 15 that we were seeing, right, I was talking about how we should enjoy a sannyasi mind, and exactly at that time this happened, right? So a sannyasi mind has died to the world, right? And how to develop a mind which is free from preoccupation. And even if preoccupations are there, the moment I say Oh, all the preoccupations should go away, right? So I was talking about this match, right? In the Wimbledon tennis match, if you see, there is a lot of screaming, right? Right? Screaming and shouting and everything. But what happens is the minute the person, the referee, says quiet, right? There's absolute silence, right? So, and then the player is able to play. Now, we should be able to have that kind of control on the mind. And when we say, okay, this is time for Shravanam, this is time for meditation, this is time for doing something else, right? So our mind should be able to take that instruction and immediately carry out that, right? So that kind of mindset to enjoy, right? That is very, very important and very much a prerequisite for Vedanti Shravanam, right? So what we do for this is very important point, right? So we call it Upasana Yoga, but in that we've already covered this in the sessions on meditation. There are two types of meditation which are very, very important, right? The first one is for Ekagrita and the other one is for Vishalata. Ekagrata means concentration, capacity to focus or converging. Just as you use a lens, right, and the sun rays, which are parallel rays, when they go through the, you know, the lens, the parallel rays converge into a normal one single point, right? So similarly, right, the scattered thoughts, if I can converge, the mental power becomes very high. So this is called Ekagrata Upasanam and it is accomplished through We've already seen this Ishta Devata Upasanam. So you choose any Devata and try to mentally do puja, etc. So whether the mind is capable of remaining in puja without any distraction, we have to see. That is what we'll have to develop, right? So it is called Ishta Devata Upasanam or Ekarupa Ishvara Upasanam. And the second type is what? Anekarupa or Vishwarupa Upasanam. So by recognizing the entire creation is a modified form of Paraprakriti, right? So Paraprakriti which lends consciousness to Aparaprakriti, and from there the entire creation comes up, right? So in the seventh chapter, we actually saw Bhumi, Raho, Nalo. The entire creation is an expression of Ishvara only. So when we visualize the entire creation as divine, which is called Vishwarupa Upasana. So in fact, this is like a tailor, because Lord Krishna is going to concentrate on Vishwarupa Upasana alone throughout these chapters that are coming up. The 11th chapter is the culmination of Vishwarupa Darshanam. So what is the advantage of Vishwarupa Upasana? The narrow-mindedness goes away. So instead of all the time remembering, you know, my family, my profession, my body, right, my mind, etc., right, very childish way, a narrow-minded way, right, our mind will expand through Vishwarupa Upasana. So that is called Upasana Yoga. So Lord Krishna refers to that in this shloka. Anye yajanto mam upasate, right? Anye yajantaha, some other people worship me, not physically or verbally. They practice mental worship, which is very, very powerful. Manasa puja, right? And second line, we see prithakvena, prithaktvena. Here it means in the form of a distinct devata. Bhagavan is visualized as one of the devatas in the world, right? And if Bhagavan is one of the persons in the world, then he is sitting somewhere, right? Then he is no different from the finite living being. So real Bhagavan cannot be a finite person, but for the sake of meditation, I visualize Bhagavan as a finite devata, prithak, prithaktvena. Not because Bhagavan is finite, but because of my facility, I require that visualization. This upasana helps me in bonding with Ishvara. And because emotional comfort requires certain relationship, human being is not an isolated animal. He is not an isolated animal. He needs relationship. So one form of creating this, you know, a permanent relationship with the Bhagavan, we accomplish, right, through Ekarupa Upasana, Ekarupa Ishvara Upasana, right? So I strike a relationship with God, right? Which is a permanent kind of relationship. So Ishta Devata Upasana is very, very good for emotional health. And I think I have mentioned this earlier. If we are even able to inculcate this in our children early in life, I believe with lots of pressures that come up during, you know, college and then your work life, this single relationship, right, with Ishta Devata will actually help that person in emotionally to be strong throughout the ups and downs of life, right? So, prithaktvena upasanam. And then the other upasana, right? So, the other upasana is vishvato mukham, right? So, Lord himself gives this, Lord Krishna calls it vishvato mukham here, vishvarupa ishvara, right? So, in Mahanarayana Upanishad also vishvato mukham comes, right? So, Vishwarupa Ishvara Upasana. So, people practice Upasana, but when he does this, what does he ask normally? His goal is, if it is moksha, then he will say, oh Lord, give me success in my spiritual journey. And for spiritual success, whatever is required, I don't even know what is required. Right? If I require purity, you give me. If I require guru, you give me. If I require the teaching, you give me, right? Jnana Vairagya Siddhyartham, right? So, without asking for anything other than spiritual success, this person indulges in this upasana, right? So, Some people are born spiritual prodigies who do not require karma yoga, upasana yoga, and they can directly enter jnana yoga. Normally, the example of Ramana Maharishi is given for that. But others cannot enter jnana yoga directly, right? Because all of us cannot be spiritual prodigies. So, jnana yoga will come once we are able to go from Ekarupa Ishvara, then to commit to Vishwarupa Ishvara, right? Then I start, automatically the curiosity will make me inquire into Paraprakriti Nirguna Brahman, which does not have form, smell, color, taste, etc. And this is the extremely abstract definition of God, that is the Arupa Ishvara. So the stepping stone is Ekarupa to Vishwarupa, which is Anekarupa to Arupa Ishvara, right? So the formless Brahman, that truth, essential truth, happens to be you. That is Tvam Asi, right? Now that cannot happen suddenly. It has to, the gradual progression of the bhakta has to take place, right? So Lord Krishna refers to that Anye. Some people who have qualified themselves through Karma Yoga and Upasana Yoga, Jnana Yajnena Upasate. They come to the Jnana Yajna, which is Vedanta Shravana Manana Nididhyasanam. So in this Jnana Yajna, they come to Ekatvena, they come to the non-dual truth, right? Where there is no subject-object duality, right? Jivatma and Paramatma are not two separate entities, but they are one and the same. So the culmination is from Dasoham, Dasaha Aham to Soham, right? Soham, that Lord, Saha is none other than I myself. Body or mind, the meaning of the word, right? I see in body, mind is the consciousness principle, and that consciousness principle is the consciousness principle, which is the essential nature of Ishvara also. So, Ekatvena Jnana Yajnena Upasate, right? So, this Ekatvena must go with the first line, Jnana Yajnena Upasate. So, today we'll stop here because I'm not able to, you know, go through the slides, rest of the slides. So, I'll take questions after we do the Purnamada. Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Any questions? I'm just going to see the question panel also. Okay. So one of the students had actually written to me about Atma and the definition of Atma, consciousness, and how can you learn more about it, right, etc. So I just wanted to, let everybody know that at this point, we are in the 9th chapter of the Gita. So many people may have the curiosity to actually learn more and more and start on this journey. So in yogamalika.org, right, because I'm unable to share the screen today, next class I will show you the screen itself. www.yogamalika.org is the website of Swamiji, and there you will actually find a catalog of what all teachings to go through at what stage, right? So Gita is normally the first set of texts that we study after Tattva Bodha. So instead of Tattva Bodha, I did the introduction to Vedanta, which covers basically the same portions as that of Tattva Bodha, but you can still, go through Tattva Bodha and then go through Upanishads, because if you want to learn more details about, Atma, the definition, And you know, these conversations, the dialogues that happen between Nachiketa and Yamadharma Raja, or any set of students in any of the other Upanishads, which are all, you know, Vedantic, you would need to go through the Upanishads. Now, to get any of these CDs of Swamiji, you can write to Shastra Prakashika. All the details are there in this yogamalika.org. There is a catalog there with the levels of studies and the corresponding CDs and where you can get them from. You can procure them and listen to them. And once you are in Chennai at some point in time, you can come attend Swamiji's class in person also. Okay. So next class, I'll actually show you the the URL and you know where it is. And I can also put the link up in the next class. So we'll have class next Sunday, same time. And if there are any other questions, I can take. Nothing else here. Let me just see if anybody has put up their hand. Yeah, okay. Yes, Shiva Subramanyam Gopalakrishnan. I think you're on mute.
Right. Yeah. Can I go ask ahead. You now? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, yes. Go ahead, Shiva.
Yeah. So typically for moksha, artha, kama, I need to cross, correct?
Yes.
But one has to cross. So this process takes a longer time. So by the time we come to moksha, which is studying spiritual scriptures, etc. So typically, as somebody said, it takes 60 years or 40, 50 years. So how to fast forward this? Is there maybe this Janma is not all that what we are talking about, but what is the way to cut short this Artha, Kama, so that the moksha part is done faster?
Okay. Now, what has been recommended, right, is that a sincere prayer, right, once you realize that there is, first of all, okay, let me explain this way. First of all, there are many people who are not even aware that moksha is a purushartha that exists. Because of some punya, we all are aware of such a goal existing. So let me assume that all of us are aware of moksha purushartha. Now, when you know that moksha purushartha is the superior purushartha and that we have come to the stage because of some punyam, and only in a human janma you will be able to do this, the first and foremost thing that we all do is sincere prayers to the Lord for jnana vairagya siddhyartham, right? So there are different kinds of prayers for this. That is what we were talking about. Kamalaga Daitashtakam is a beautiful prayer exactly for Sadhana Chatushtaya Sampattihi, which is, you know, Viveka, Vairagya, Shamadhi Shatka Sampattihi and Mumukshutvam. So by praying for that, praying to that God sincerely, and by indulging in more and more karma yoga, and that karma yoga itself, because we now have the knowledge that we must not be indulged in sakama bhakti but nishkama bhakti, if we can change the prayers from a selfish prayer to the prayer for lokakshemartham, gradually what happens is our mind starts getting refined. And you can actually see that in some people's case, it gets really fast tracked. And even within 1 or 2 years, you can see that the earning or the longing to go fast on the spiritual journey happens, and they are on real fast track. You can see that. And it happens naturally. So it is just that a sincere prayer and sincere effort is what is required. And being conscious and aware of Pancha Maha Yajna and doing everything with Ishwara Arpana Bhava, Prasada Bhava, with a nishkama, without expecting results for yourself, but for the world at large. If we practice all of these, automatically the mental refinement happens and we can see a change in our own lives, the way we deal with people, interact with people, and then, you know, our own spiritual journey. I hope I've answered your question.
Mostly, yes. The only thing is, by the time we do see the change in ourselves, over a period of time after coming to these classes, listening to these courses. But by that time, we feel known the most of the scriptures are in Sanskrit. To know the correct meaning and chant, etc., the knowledge of Sanskrit is a must. So we sometimes feel maybe we have lost significant time in doing it. Maybe I think, as you said, more the prayer, more the blessings, probably the next generation will, next Janma probably will pass forward.
Okay, Shiva, very important point Swamiji says is, Sanskritam is not a prerequisite for this. And that is why Swamiji has made sure that it is available in simple English. And repeated hearing, you will actually get used to all the terms that I'm using. By now, all of you must have got used to it. Because, you know, you repeatedly speak. So you don't have to worry about Sanskrit knowledge at all, right? Because there are very many students I see who do not have Sanskrit knowledge. Because Swamiji makes it so simple in English, it is enough if you are able to follow in English and you are able to just, you know, imbibe and understand the meaning of it. That's all.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Nobody else. So next week, same time, we'll meet. Sorry for the glitch. I actually didn't notice that I had started going out of power on my laptop. That is why this happened. Hari Om. We'll see you next week.